Hello, and welcome back to another episode of the Help on the Way podcast. I am your host for the evening, Fig, here with my good friend, Knob. And our new friend of the pod and our new host for the evening, Knob's dad. Say hello, Knob's dad.
Hey, hello. How are you guys?
Great. Thanks for coming. The reason that we've invited Knob's dad, and frequent listeners of the show will remember that...
The reason that we invited Knob's dad is because he needed something to do tonight. The Rangers are off.
True. And Knob's dad is a huge deadhead and followed the dead around, and was indeed in Philadelphia on March 23rd, 1986, which is the weekly show. So we thought, hey, let's get Knob's dad in. Let's hear, you know, from Knob's dad. Let's hear about the show. Let's get into it as we normally do with some Channel 6. This is our news segment. I guess the first news would be, how about Jay Blakesburg last week? That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that was real cool.
Yeah, very excellent. I'm glad that we could have him on the show, and he was so much fun, totally cool, and I wish him all the best. Actually, let's start with that. I wish him all the best in Vegas, doing all the, all the fun surrounding Dead & Company's Sphere residency, which starts, well... tomorrow, which is actually when this podcast is coming out.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you're listening to this episode, it's happening tonight.
It's today.
And we all thoughts loved on... when they opened with Shakedown Street. I'm just going to say that, and we'll edit it if I'm wrong.
Knob's dad, any thoughts?
To open that show up. Damn, that's a good call.
Oh, I got one.
Shakedown, that place would rock. What do you got first?
Well, this isn't an opener, but it would continue with the whole Sphere metaphor, the wheel.
Yeah, I think
they could pull that off, but it's not an opener, but they could pull it off.
I think they're going to do like a touch or something. But I don't know. I'm not going without the streams. It's kind of rough.
Right. So that's part of the Channel 6 that we want to talk about is the news. We've known for a long time that Dead & Company are starting a residency. Now, what is it, 24 nights through July?
24 nights. Yeah, May to July.
However, no official streams. So very different than Dead & Company runs in the past. No couch tours. If you want to see the dead in, the closest thing to the dead,
Dead & Company. Careful.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough. If you want to see them, you got to go to Vegas.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to like whine, because at the end of the day, they can do whatever the hell they want and I'll live, but I'm a little bummed. I would like to have watched some of those shows. And I like doing the couch tour, obviously. That's my whole deal. But, at the end of the day, it's what they're going to do. Me whining isn't going to change anything. And I'll spend the summer being really into fish.
Per the usual. Practically speaking, though, what this means is, at least from a Reddit perspective, we won't have those, set list threads. No. There won't be any reaction. So, this tour will very much happen, but kind of in a different way, kind of behind the scenes than what we're used to from Dead & Company for the last 8 years or whatnot. So,
it's kind of backwards for almost everything they stand for. This is crazy that there, the lack of communication they want to go with doing this.
Yeah.
Not to show it and stuff, and it just seems weird. I hope it changes.
I hope it changes too. And I'm completely speculating, but I could see it changing. Knob was saying that Fish was able to do it, but they only had 4 nights. Maybe during the last leg, they'll cash in and do a couch tour.
Yeah, there might be a world where they stream like the last three shows or something that last weekend.
Right, right. Because, I mean, even Fare Thee Well was streamed, and that wasn't even Dead & Company. So, I mean, like, clearly, you know, that's part of the thing here. So, yeah, I wouldn't count out streams.
Because up until, because with the first time that we really didn't, outside of like one-off festival and such, it started this year with the Dead Ahead shows in Mexico. Those also were not streamed. And now these Dead & Co. shows similarly aren't being streamed. So I do wonder if it is some sort of internal change of opinion on the streaming of it all versus the live experience. Because at the end of the day, these bands are about the live experience, but not everyone can participate in the live experience, which is why I've always appreciated having the couch tour, having the streams. So even when I can't be there, I can still experience the music in some way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's becoming, I mean, maybe Knobstab is, you know, getting to this point, but like it's becoming kind of a pay to play. Like, if you want to see them, you got to go either to Mexico and stay at a resort, which I think is unreasonable, or the, maybe I could talk myself into that. You know, Vegas is it's not easy either. It's maybe, you know, for deadheads in California, it's a little bit easier than us out in the East Coast. But yeah, it's not that easy.
No.
But we're looking forward to it. And you know, you know, sitting where we were last summer, being like, is this it? Are we done? You know, it's cool to have an answer to that question, which is no. It's just you have to go to Vegas for the residency.
Yeah, they pretty much made the comments about being done touring. But I think Mayer broke that out at one time in an interview about, you know, not necessarily done playing.
Right.
So, and now here they are.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe they'll have another run in Madison Square Garden. Or the well, not the Spectrum.
No.
Wells Fargo Center. Well, the Spectrum is where we had our weekly show, which is why I went to it. But we do have a couple other Channel 6 news items before. That would have been great to do that, yeah. But a little too clever by half, maybe. Knob, why don't you tell us about Phil's Terrapin Clubhouse releasing its first episode. Is this the long-awaited podcast?
This is not the podcast. This is Phil has two projects that he's announced recently with online content, one of which is the podcast, which is not released yet. He's also doing on his YouTube channel, Terrapin Clubhouse, what he calls a Dark Star-a-thon, where he's going to put together a bunch of bands to play never-ending Dark Star. And they released the first episode. It featured a band with, I think it was just the Phil's Cap Run band, but with Holly Bowling on keys instead of Jason Crosby. So Daniel Donato was there, John Molo, Graham Lesh, Nikki Bloom, Phil, and Holly Bowling. It's cool. It's a really pretty Dark Star. It's about 30 minutes all in all. It's worth a listen.
Cool. And they're still doing that? Like, that's still the idea? Or
yeah, the plan is to do a few more. I mean, as many as they can swing. There was a picture posted. Apparently, O'Teal plays drums in an upcoming Dark Star-a-thon Dark Star.
And O'Teal would play drums. Well, he would play drums in the Drums in Space segments for
yeah, he would participate in Drum Space.
He's a rhythm devil.
Yeah, yeah, honorary rhythm devil.
Yeah, it's his horns.
Cool. So, and where can we find the Terrapin Clubhouse show?
YouTube.
YouTube. Okay. Excellent.
Yeah.
Cool. And then our last piece of news, and this is something I hadn't heard before, but we are getting, or maybe we have got, in the past week, a live single of Ship of Fools in anticipation of the Mars Hotel 50th release. Knob, word about that?
Yeah. So for they're releasing the Grateful Dead's Mars Hotel album for its 50th anniversary, like they've done with Working Man's and American Beauty and Wake of the Flood. And like those other releases, there was an Angel Share, which was already released, and they're also pairing it with a live show from the era. In this case, it's going to be Las Vegas, 5/12/74. They've released one single now in anticipation of that, a live nice. Cut of Ship of Fools from that show, which is on the Mars Hotel album. It sounds good. I'm looking forward to that release. They've always been good shows paired with these album re-releases.
Cool. Well, and go ahead.
Well, what about the Ship of Fools from Giant Stadium that they have out there?
Yeah, that one's also good.
Yeah, that's another fun one that they did. So this ought to sound really good.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent. And there's actually some tie in there with the Sphere Run as the Ship Vegas of Fools that they're releasing. The Vegas of it all. The Omega, yeah. Alpha and the Omega of the Vegas of it all. So cool. I mean, I don't think Ship of Fools is a single, but you know, it's cool to get some new content out there, and looking forward to the 50th anniversary of Mars Hotel. Pretty cool. All right, so we are going to segue into our featured weekly show. This was March 23rd, 1986. As Knob's dad remembers, this was a Sunday show at the Spectrum in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Spectrum, no more.
No more.
No more, but the dad owned the Spectrum and played there quite often. So I think before I get into a set-by-set breakdown, I'm just going to ask Knob's dad, what were your recollections of the show? You know, the last time you were on, you had some excellent stories about, the before and after of the show.
Sure,
I'm not sure if you had the biggest recollection of the show itself for various reasons, but, you know, just generally, you know, do you recall the show, or, you know, what's your story?
Well, actually, this was great because, I saw him a few months before this in at the Meadowlands, I think, where they kind of ended it. So then this was, I didn't make it to Hampton, but the big rumor was that, you know, there might be a box of rain coming out. So we were all excited and jumping around. And then a buddy of mine, we had tickets for all three nights. So, you know, the Spectrum was like a kind of like a crazy environment down there. And we drove down from, New Jersey and took the ride, and two of us, and got inside. And, you know, next thing you know, they break out, they give me some Lovin', and Phil's behind it. And they just seem like, you know, just tight and on fire.
Yeah.
So, you know, they kind of rock that 100%. And then you kind of hear a little tease for like a Candyman. And like my buddy and I kind of, you know, it brought back so many memories. Listen to this to be able to talk to you guys tonight. So I remember that. And then all of a sudden, like a deal comes out. And, you know, we're jumping up and down. And, after that, you know, I witnessed Bobby, you know, doing the hand jive to us, you know, in the middle of the Spectrum. So, you know, it was just such like the opener just never stopped. It just like rolled and rolled, you know, and then all of a sudden here come the Candyman.
Wow.
So, yeah, I was 20 and you know, we are just, you know, absolutely, you know, jumping up, and the whole place is rocking. I mean, that Spectrum was like, you know, the clap and the sound would just echo and just vibrate around and just pulsate. And you just felt it, you know, in all parts of your body, depending, you know, what part of the song was going down. So, you know, and then, the Cassidy came out, and the West LA, because they played a few at Meadowlands with that off that album. So, you know, that was like that. You know, everyone was going crazy for that. And then we got the Mama Tribe, Big River, Might As Well. But Jerry's voice and his playing and you know, the way Brent was looking at him, it brought back a lot of memories and stuff. So it was a really good first set.
Cool. So when you're listening to these shows, like, does it bring back memories? Like, I mean, clearly you're not thinking about 3/23/86 at any given time of your life, but like when you hear, you know, Phil come in with "Give Me Some Lovin'," you know, like the bass line coming in, like, Like, how does that relate to your memories? Like, does it trigger a lot of them, or like, you know, is it visceral like that?
In these particular shows is one of the guys I went with was a very close friend of mine, and he's not around anymore. Mm. So like a lot of these memories, you know, he was one of the original, you know, guys that I went with. And so when I see it, you know, I do spark like memories, you know. I've had some like wild times in these shows, you know, going right. to see these and stuff. But the first night that we went, it was like me and him together. It just like, I remember going down with him because these were, you know, it was the first of three. And then the second night we had a friend come in from Colorado. He was going to, he was on spring break. So he came with us that night, was able to get a ticket. And then the following night it was me and my buddy again. So like at that aspect, but I just remember like how amped up like the entire film, like from going into the parking lot and tailgating and then right. getting into this place. It was just like the place was just ready to explode. And wow. this opening night, they seemed to pull that off, you know, especially that night as well.
Very cool. Just one final question here. Did you have a favorite night? You said this was the first of three, so they played Sunday the 23rd, Monday the 24th, and then Tuesday the 25th. Do you recall one that stuck out?
The middle night for me.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, what the they did a Lost Saint morning do that was just like, you know, that just, you know, it got me at this particular point in my, you know, touring and stuff like that, but. You know, yeah. all three nights was probably, you know, in all honesty, it was like the tightest. Like Jerry was just on fire. He was excited. It was generated. Bobby, you know, Bobby's wearing, you know, cowboy boots, long pants, you know, jumping around with his collared shirt. You know, he was showing us the hand jive while he was singing. You know, he's 100%, you know, had the animation going on with that. You know, everyone was just screaming and clapping and just. You know, there was, I don't think there was a person sitting down during this run of the spectrum.
Awesome. Now I'm breaking a promise because I need you to explain to, the audience and to, the co-hosts, the podcasters that don't know what is doing the hand jive.
You know, I think it's like Willie Dixon, and he's at, you know, I don't know the exact, you know, he had the whole like hands were going up and down, side to side, up, and you know, he just kept his guitar, you know, on his side, and he was doing the whole, you know, I remember it was like up like side, and you know, you looked around, and whether you did it, whether you were doing it properly or not, like there's all sorts of people moving their hands around. So I went with the flow, you know. I'm not saying that's awesome. I pulled it off either, but it, you know, it was certainly a lot of fun.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, he was very animated at this point of like, you know, as I remember, you know, Bobby and stuff jumping back and forth. You know, it was just so much fun to see him, and you know, getting the scream out and, you know, doing what he did. But yeah, this was definitely a great time.
Awesome. Nob, thoughts? Set one?
I liked it. I thought it was good. It's got a really good energy, like Dad was saying. And I think that permeates even through the tape. I had a tough time sitting down listening to this one. This is one where just listening to it, I was brought to my feet to dance for a good chunk of it. It's a really fun show. Gimme Some Lovin' is a really great energy to the opener. The Phil and Brent vocals are honestly really sharp. And it's not often that you can say this. But I think Bob and Jerry are letting Phil down vocally on this one. That's probably the first and last time you could say a sentence like that. It's got a great, it's so much fun. It's just the right tempo to let it really cook. And then the deal is awesome. That's one of my highlights truly of the show. It's got a great boogie-woogie feel. It's a fast, spirited rendition. If this deal does not make you get up and dance, what are we doing here, people? We get to the hand jive. Yeah, it was such a fun deal. It just had the sauce. Everything, every note Jerry played was just the right note to keep that energy building. You could really feel the crowd feeding the band and the band feeding the crowd and that kind of feedback loop of enthusiasm as early as Deal. One of my favorite bits. Oh, there you go.
I was going to say, you break out a Gimme, Sullivan, Deal, you could almost follow that with anything. Hand Jive was just awesome. It just fit in the right spot. And you know, Bobby loved every minute of it.
Well, it's so funny. Right before it starts, the soundboard, I was listening to the Charlie Miller soundboard for this show. And right before it starts, you can hear Jerry just off mic say, "Okay, you can do it." As if Bobby's been bugging him to play this Hand Jive song for weeks. And he's finally like, "Whatever, fine, go. Do it."
It's just Philly.
Yeah, it's very silly. But yeah, Bobby gets really into it. It's the crowd loves it. I like at one point Brent actively teases "I got candy" because that's built on that same Bo Diddley beat. Yeah. And he throws in a little bam 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 on his organ.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Candyman is a lot of fun. It starts off nice and sensitive and then knows when and how to be big. It's a very alive rendition. Cassidy's got great energy. It is fast. Bob and Brent's harmonies start off a little wonky, but they really click, and it's really special. The jam is really cool. It's not a long time, but a good time. A slinky West LA fadeaway with an interesting, unique synth sound from Brent, some hot Jerry solos, a jaunty, solid Mama Tried, Big River, delivering some awesome solos from everybody. And then I really liked how Might As Well brings things to close. Jerry's having so much fun with the vocals. He is shredding his fingers off with the guitar. The band in general is giving great energy. There's clean hits, energetic backing vocals. It's a really good first set, all in all, but it really nails its first and last impression. Yeah, I like this first set a lot. What did you think, Fig?
Sure. I liked this first set less so than you all. I did like set two a lot more. Spoiler and being a dead downer.
You're right about this.
Yeah, well,
we have a guest here, and you're going to contradict him. We have my dad on the podcast, and you're going to tell my dad to my face that he's wrong.
Well, I haven't even discussed the second set yet. So, song center, we're like, wow. So, yeah,
we all have different opinions. I'm ready for it. Yeah, you guys have like a mind meld going on. I don't have to be a part of that. That's okay. And Game, by the way, fully agrees with everything I'm about to say.
No,
I will start.
He did not listen to this show.
He did not. I did tell Game, I was like, dude, you got to listen to those drums in space. Because, spoiler, I really
There's
didn't
no
like the
way.
Drums in space.
It is a
there's
really
no
good drums.
Did.
There's no
it's
way
a really
he's
good
listening
drums
to it.
Space. No, there's no way. Game is off this week.
You may as well have asked him to fly.
Yeah. So... All right, so I'm going to get into it. This was a decent Miller board. There is a real shame here with the sources on the archive. There is a Tobin Matrix, which is not available to stream, only download. And I've never seen this before when clicking around. I don't know what's going on, if it's something with the archive or something with just I think it's Kevin Tobin putting up stuff on the archive. I would have loved to hear a Matrix of this show because the odds were not great. The soundboards were better, so I kept with the soundboard. But I think a Matrix would have been perfect.
Yeah, and this is feel, a show where you want to hear a little audience energy.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, hearing, you know, Nob's dad talking about it, you know, I really wish I got that perspective, and I probably would have a different takeaway of the first set, which, spoiler alert, I didn't like as much as you guys did. Now,
we're
you
fighting
still
in the
could
parking lot after this.
Okay, all right.
I know you're from Philly, but we're fighting in the parking lot.
Well, yeah, we'll meet up halfway in Trenton and fight.
Yeah.
So you could access Tobin's Matrix, but you have to download each song individually. And that was, you know, fans, I love you. That's something I'm not going to do. All right, so it starts off with Gimme Some Lovin', and Knob completely on board with you. Phil and Brent is not a bad vocal pairing.
You don't think it would work, and then it does.
Yeah, it worked great. Well, truthfully, I mean, you know how I feel about Phil singing, and yeah. I will probably give more credit to Brent for just being that incredible of a vocalist to raise Phil to a level that it was actually pretty nice. So we started with that, and then, yeah, we crash into Deal. I do say that Jerry and Brent are definitely a better vocal pairing, and we get that in Deal, and Jerry has this screaming guitar tone, which I loved. And, yeah, we jump into Willie and the Hand Jive, a rarity. It was fun. It wasn't really played from the source that I was hearing with any real zip. Bo Diddley beat was kind of halting. It didn't really like carry through. I don't know what was going on there. Bobby wants to play Let It Grow. Oh, so this was interesting. Like afterwards, Bobby was playing the first chord into Let It Grow, which really wouldn't make sense here in that part of the set. But maybe he was just tuning. Cool. I don't know what. But Jerry wins and busts into Candyman, which was okay. We get into Cassidy. Had a decently adventurous middle jam. West LA. Now, Jerry's vocals, at least in the first set, were kind of croaky, and this one was very croaky. West LA just kind of ends. We get into Mama Tried, Big River. Not much for Mama Tried for Big River. Brent, I said, wins the solo competition. Yeah, there were some interesting tones that Brent was getting out of his synths tonight, and there was a really cool one in Big River that is not to be missed. And set one, or really the show in general, I think really came to life with Might As Well. This one was a bop. Another thing about the show is we get forgetful lyric Jerry. So, so we get that at Might As Well, carries into set two. Jerry does make up for it with some excellent Might As Well refrains and just some more rock and roll. So that is our review of set one. Let's break into set two. Starts with a Shakedown Street into a Samson because it was a Sunday show. We get into He's Gone, Spoonful, Drums in Space. That tips over into the other one. To another rarity, Comes a Time, into Good Lovin', and then we encore with Day Job. I'm going to keep talking. I have some stuff I want to say.
Yeah, get it off your chest.
Yeah, I'm just going to get off my chest. I have actually a lot more to say about set two than set one. Shakedown was good. Again, Jerry has really the foggiest idea about how the lyrics in the song goes as he mumbles through a number of verses. But the jam at the end when he did not require Jerry singing was actually pretty good. With Samson, Jerry seems to have woken up with this one. He's ripping off some pretty incredible riffs throughout. And I wrote there's a new champion for best solo of the night. So he takes the belt back from Brent and Samson there. He's gone. Jerry finally sounds great. Really, I like to sing in this one. Bobby has some really interesting comp work going on here with some distinctive tone. If you're ever wondering what Bobby brings to the band, listen to this show and specifically He's Gone, and you'll learn. In Spoonful, I really like this it was kind of a slower than usual blues here. And it wasn't too long, but soon we hear something that reminded me of Lord of the Rings, the drums in the deep, like something portending the doom in Moria. I'm guessing it was Mickey on timpanis or some sort of low drums, because that kind of sparks this really incredible drums that was so cool for me. Because it starts with like a bunch of low drum work, and then it turns into something that was like krautrock. And for me, it was interesting because my musical journey took me at one point through like David Bowie, Brian Eno, which, you know, Eno did a lot of work and Bowie did a lot of work with like those krautrock bands.
Well, you're
like
still
Cluster.
An Eno nut.
New. I am an Eno nut. I'm actually the moderator of our Eno, www.red.com.
I wasn't going to bring Eno. That up, but yeah.
So I'm keeping that alive on the internet. It was interesting. It was like, I've never heard 4/4 in drums, but there was like 4/4 and like, you know, just the sounds coming out, I'm guessing of the beam. It just sounded like, I don't know. It sounded like the rock music coming out of, Germany in the 70s. It was really cool. Mm. And that led us into space, which I thought was also really good. And actually, so the drums then start doing a Bo Diddley beat. So we're now back to hand jive. We get these pulsing background sounds. The guitars merge into something resembling wind chimes, which actually worked. I don't know how they're on the fly making these sounds work together. It's really cool. This point, go ahead. Or you just agreeing?
No, I was just agreeing with you.
Okay, great.
You just made a really salient point.
Thank you. I appreciate that. At this point, the sounds turn rather pleasant with some good Jerry and Bob Weir wanking. I mean, interplay. I didn't know that's where my notes went. So there's some noodling. And then we get into the other one. Again, some really cool sounds going on here. Bobby with some crazy string bends. And then I guess there's the beam is doing some witch's wails. I don't know where these witch's wails are coming from, but scared my dog. Something crazy, high-pitched. Healy puts a demonic effect on Bob's vocals for the bus.
Go ahead. I didn't want to cut you off, but we used to call those the whale sounds.
Those
screeches. It was weird. That's what we used to say back then. It was cool.
Oh, my. I mean, it was cool. It was cool to listen to. If I were there, if I were under some certain influences, I'd be out of my mind.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't like the demonic effect. I didn't think it was very needed, especially because Bobby was really singing in his kind of Elvis voice. So like the next verse, when there was no demonic effect, it was just Elvis. And I was like, okay. The other one was short. It was pretty quick transfer into Comes a Time. Jerry actually belts this one out pretty good, given the first set. It probably has Jerry's best solos of the night. He played two there at the end. And I think this may have been a night that Jerry just wanted to play the blues. His blues songs were really good. But Jerry kind of got, you know, the band segued pretty quickly then into Good Loving. It wrote, It's La Bamba Time. And then I wrote, does Bobby talk about Jesus? He talks about it there being a Sunday sermon. He talks about thousands of years ago, a man wanted to bring some light into the world. And then he segues into calling it a love light. And I was like, I'm not sure that's what they were talking about with love light. But I've never heard the Dead go overtly religious. That was news to me. Interesting, but news. And Day Jobs at the end was a good way to end set two. So yeah, I had a lot. Set two really turned me on more than set one, I think. But who wants to go? Nob's dad?
Sure. Like I said, going back so many years with this, you know, some of the things I just remember, you know, for perspective is that like the Shakedown, when they opened up with that, this place just started like rocking. It was just, everyone was screaming, everyone was going nuts, whether they were back to their seats or getting there, that this place, and I don't know if that was just the spectrum, you know, the building within itself being a small size or whatever, but it was just bouncing off all walls when that was going on. Yeah. And, you know, they never stopped with the drumming and the sound. And then, you know, when they just went into a Samson. So, you know, it was just, you know, I'd be lying if I could tell you like each song and each particular note they were doing at that time. You know, I do remember the being able to see a Comes a Time and see a Bobby, you know, rapping the Good Loving, you know, when all said and was done at the end. And in all honesty, was a little bit bummed about the day job for my encore, but that's here and there. But yeah, no, it was just such a fun, loud concert. Like if you listen to it, like everyone's clapping at this point, you know, it was like a pretty big sing-along. If I remember there, I think there was more people singing, you know, out loud, especially during the He's Gone, you know, like that was going on. But, you know, everyone was just, I think just that made it into the spectrum that night was just having such a fun time. And, you know, in what, you know, from being there and kind of remember, you know, I just remember that like you walked out of there going, wow, man, they were on tonight. Nice. And you didn't get that all the time. But this particular night, you walked out of there going, you know, because you had the people that went to the Hamptons already, like, you know, kind of rubbing it in at you that you didn't make it out, you know, down to Virginia first. So, you know, and then this came about, and I was like, God damn, man, this, you know, the spectrum rocked right now. Night one was, you know, it's only going to get better. So,
yeah.
But
now, this comes a time, is that one you would be, you know, looking for, looking to catch on tour?
No, that's a great question. Right there, I'm thinking Wharf Rat Buddy, and that's my favorite song, you know,
it's definitely the Wharf Rat spot.
Yeah. And if my buddy was around, he would have told you, because, you know, when this first came, he was jumping up and down, and I kind of had that look like, man, this was my Wharf Rat, but it just didn't come. You know, I'm glad you said that, but I 100% was thinking that right there. You know, I'll take that, you know, each night. I just love the way he sang that and what he did with that. But, you know, comes a time special also. So, you know, my buddy kind of got me to like realize that more. But if you're asking me, I'll be like, boom, write it in right now and I'll take it.
I appreciate the candor.
What's that? You had already heard them play Comes a Time in Hershey Park at your second show. So that might have warped in your brain how rare a song this is.
So, yeah, I didn't think about that. That's it's good to, that you have some of those stats, Abby. That helped.
Yeah. Bob has stats for everybody.
I've got a whole file.
You gotta watch yourself.
Oh, I know he does.
I have every guest who's ever been on the show's social security number. This is a true fact about the show.
Right, FBI files.
One little thing I'll throw out the wind, who people who are listening that might have been around or 1986, but you know, if people that were walking around the parking lot and chilling out at Shakedown Street, they probably heard about a thing called a Gooney Bird. And they were involved with some of these concerts that came around at that time. And I believe in some of the, in a few books or two, they'll talk about what that was during the 1986 tour. And it was fun. That's all I got to say.
What? Okay, I got to drill down into that. You're saying Gooney Bird? Bird? Like,
yes, sir.
Like bird. Okay.
A Gooney Bird.
Okay. Do you want
a term on the lot back in 1986?
The meaning?
You'd have to look that up. But that was very popular at this particular time. So,
okay.
Yeah. Right. Inside the spectrum. The
Urban Dictionary, then.
So. But we can move on. We can continue with the other songs that were involved.
Okay. Knob?
Yeah, I'll share some thoughts. I really like the second set. I think set one might do it for me more in this show, but I do think that set two is a lot more ambitious in what it's going for. Set two starts with a really tight, an energetic, fast shakedown to start. Like Fig mentioned, Jerry kind of mumbles his way through more than one verse of this song. It's got a really good groove. The jam never goes like crazy, but it always stays fun. It is a blast. Samson is cool. I like how it opens. It takes a little bit of time to start coming together, and you can kind of hear the band building it. I think that's cool. The jam has a really great build underneath Jerry's solo. I loved when Bobby came in while Jerry was still going, and then Jerry started playing some licks underneath him. Yeah, it was a really cool sound.
Yeah, I love when bands do that. Like, that's even if unintentionally. Like, it's a cool sound. It's a cool feeling. It's live. It's fun. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a fun. It provided a fun little counter melody. He's gone. Is really cool. There's a lot of emotion even as Jerry is mixing up his verses. It's a very unique vocal jam towards the end. I'm going to briefly geek out from a music theory standpoint, and I promise that it's sort of interesting. Normally, as the band is singing the "Ooh, nothing's going to bring him back," they mostly just play the riff of "He's Gone," the same E major chord. Here, they throw in some different chords. They throw in the 4 and the 5, the A and the B, in a way that almost sounds like the opening riff to Sugar Magnolia. It misses that slide, but it's the same feel of 1-4, 1-5 chords. It then leads to, I've never heard them do that on He's Gone before. And it then leads, they continue that chord progression into the outro jam. And it's a very different sounding outro jam tonically than you normally get with this song. It's a really unique rendition. Spoonful is fun. I really liked drums. I really did. It was a bunch of solid grooves that were all different and all enjoyable, and none of them outstayed their welcome. It started sounding like a marching band at first, and then they kind of flirted with going back into Samson's, and then they threw in the Not Fade Away, the Bo Diddley beat again. There was that cool echo effect. I enjoyed just about everything that was played during drums, and I really liked Space. There was a really delay loop heavy jam. It sounded like they were going into a ballad out of space, and then Jerry comes in with the other one riff, and that's a really well-timed other one. It really helps with the energy. It is short, but it is fun. There's a little of those distorted Bobby vocals. I really like Brent's keyboard lines that he adds in the second half of the other one. Comes a time, the vocals take a second to click. The first verse, Jerry's sounding a little rough, but once he finds the voice, once he finds his ability to sing the song, it is a beautiful rendition of Comes a Time. This is probably the prettiest, this is probably the most beautiful guitar solo that Jerry Garcia plays tonight. He makes that guitar sing, and it is an awesome rendition of Comes a Time. Good Lovin' is a really solid rendition, and then Bob starts freestyle rapping about Jesus.
Well, he was running all over the place at this point, too, you got him.
And then to go into Lovelight, it was scattered, I thought.
He tends to start throwing Love Light into Good Lovin', but it's the Jesus of it all that makes this one. It's just so, because there's the little bit of the fact that they always play Samson and Delilah on Sunday, because that one's Bible themed. But
that's true.
That's a little less direct of a sermon than Bobby, who opens by going, "I'm going to try to deliver y'all a sermon, and I hope it rhymes." It's like, all right. My name's Bob Weir, and I'm here to say Jesus Christ is A-OK.
We have our so-cho title.
And then Day Job is it's a fast day job.
Is that the joke? Is that the joke? Keep your day job, Bobby, because you're not a sermonizer.
I also want to point out, this is the third to last time they would ever play Keep Your Day Job. They played it once more on the 27th of this month, and then the final one in April 4th, which we've had on the show a couple of years ago. I always swear it's the one good day job. this is the third to last time they would ever play it, which makes it very interesting in that regard. The 86 day jobs always fascinate me in that way. Oh, I got to get more hobbies.
Speaking of more hobbies, we have a couple of different featurettes here, so we will ask the co-hosts here whether this show would make your Book of the Dead. And Knob's Dad, does this one make your Book of the Dead for listening to it this week? Does it make your, is this like a particularly memorable show for you? Is it more so now after having this experience? What are your thoughts?
Oh, yeah. No, 100%. I like I said, it's the three of these kind of, clicking together. I had a leaving the spectrum on the night after that. I had a pretty memorable, or kind of a crazy experience leaving a concert due to the Philly fans. But,
And you're wearing a Rangers cap, so.
No. Like I said, we were actually leaving the spectrum, and a bunch of people came raging through. There was 10 or 12 of them. They were kind of wearing these leather jackets and things, and you know, we were at a red light waiting to go, and then next thing you know, our car just started rocking. These guys, where are you going? And we're in this car, and my buddy like jumps up and he starts locking the windows. He's like rolling, you know, we had to roll them up. We're in this Honda Civic. These deers like foot, they're banging on the top. He's yelling, go, go, go. You know, we're at a red light. You know, there's cars in front of us. I was like, yeah, and finally, that as soon as that light like remotely turned green, because I was driving, I just you know, punched it, like took off. And I was like, you know, what the hell was that, man? It was like, you know, that you know, almost a crazy experience leaving the Spectrum. But yeah, that was the night after that. But then the third night, it was peaceful. So,
On behalf of, as a former Philadelphian, I apologize.
No, hey, I was there. Actually, the first night there, we had the pagans kind of rolled in. You know, we were just tailgating. They didn't bother us or anything, but there was like about, you know, 25 to like maybe, you know, 30 motorcycles kind of all rolled in together. Yeah. You know, kind of took a spot of the lot. And I was like, you know, we'll go kind of this way, you know.
Yeah.
So, but
what a scene.
No harm, no foul. I just mean that, you know, I just seen them all roll in. It was kind of after the show and stuff like that. And, you know, we're just trying to work our way back up. Yeah, we drove back to Jersey each night after these three, so it was kind of nutty.
So would this make your Book of the Dead? Would this be one that you come back to to listen to from time to time in the future? Or has it been?
Oh, no, 100%. But from listening to it today, I'm thoroughly impressed. But I was like, you know, because 86 gets a bum rap towards the end of the summer and stuff like that, you know, and everything. But, you know, a lot of people forget, like when they first came out, you know, and started this, you know, spring tour and stuff, they were totally rocking and stuff. So, you know, when the whole incident with Jerry and everything that occurred after that, it was just like, you know, it was like, you know, hitting a brick wall. You're like, what?
Right. Yeah. Cause it's just a couple months later, the coma happens, right?
What's that, Jeff?
It's a couple months later in July 86, right? Well, August 86, yeah, that Jerry would slip into the coma.
When you were at the show before Jerry's coma or a couple of shows before?
I went to the shows, 86. I went up to Buffalo and saw the Dead do the 4th of July show there where they streamed Live Aid. Mm. And then I shot down and saw the last two shows in Washington, D.C. where... Wow. Jerry does the, you know, they do the Satisfaction, and Jerry's like, my best friend in the whole wide world, Mr. Bob Weir.
No.
And the next thing you know, they're like, Jerry's in a coma. So it's kind of like that type of thing, you know. So, but yeah, it was like, it was crazy at that point. But it was like, I remember the shows I watched, they were like really short and stuff like that, you know, and he was having a heart. Plus, it was like 100, you know, they were squirting people down. It was ungodly hot and humid. Yeah, those particular 2 days.
Very cool. All right, Nob, Book of the Dead.
Yeah, I think so.
Oh boy.
I was thoroughly impressed.
Don't make me do it.
No, it's okay. You don't have to do it. You don't have to do it.
It's going to be a no. It's a no for old Fig. But I will say, as I alluded to earlier directly, set two was my set. Nob?
I actually think it's set one for me.
Nob's dead.
I'm so set two.
Set two. Okay. I won't. I got my desired outcome. I'm gonna just shut up. All right. And then our final little featurette here is
agrees with me.
Oh yeah, that's to be seen. The Mother Trucker, which is our MVP of the night, and usually. Typically, that would be the player who's the most valuable player, so one of the musicians. However, Jay Blakesburg introduced the idea that maybe we should have a Mother Trucker for song. So, Nob's dad, who was your favorite player of the night, and what was your favorite song?
I'm going to have to go with the Shakedown Street, because that's what I remember, you know. The Gimme Some Love and got everything going, but I just remember being there and this whole place just started going unbelievably loud and crazy. So I'm taking a Shakedown Street, and you know, as much as I love this band and everything, you know, I'm a true Jerry guy hand in hand. So you know, mess. Maybe he might miss a verse here or there, but you know what? That's my boy. So,
oh yeah,
he's my MVP.
Okay, Knob.
I honestly don't know who my MVP is player wise. I think it might be Billy. I think this show is as alive. I mean, the show is as alive as it is because the whole band is reacting off the crowd. Truly, one of the MVPs of the show is the audience with the energy they feed into the band. But for someone on the stage, probably the drummers that are given this show life. In terms of song, that is easy for me. That is Deal. Deal is Deal. My highlight of this show. It ripped.
Okay, cool. I like the Rhythm Devils as well tonight. I don't think I'm going to change my mind about that. And it goes into, I'll just say the both Rhythm Devils, because it's hard for me to differentiate. And that goes into my MVP song, which was actually Drums in Space, which is kind of cool for me because that's not one that I would.
Interesting. That would, yeah, drums would be that up took there me places. For me tonight.
That took me places, yep. Yeah, and it no was surprising. Yeah, it was really cool.
Well, you know, okay. What also, if you actually Google the show and look, you know, you notice the drum set with Billy and Mickey is like way smaller. They don't have the that big like drum set up around their head and stuff like that. I have to Google it before we
is there a video of this one? Is this one on YouTube?
There actually is. You have to go like almost like past the Hand Jive. The second set comes in real well, but for some reason there's all sorts of like, you know, different, you know, zeroing in, but the sound of it is phenomenal, so it's definitely worth checking out.
Okay. Yeah, I need to be more cognizant of what's on YouTube because there's so much. It's pretty cool. Let's get into our next segment, which is Reddit comments. I'll just read these for time. We have, let's see here, Great FL1 Texas 2, who says, my first comes a time, heart. So maybe Knob's dad's friend, or a friend of Knob's dad. We have Deadco Rocks, frequent commenter of the show, who says, excellent. We went to the show the next day. Another friend of Knob's dad. Drove out from Chicago, caught the second box of rain. Good times. And finally, we have Barn Alumni 1999. This was an awesome shakedown. I missed set one and had just gotten in before set two. I made my way to the edge of the second level with my legs hanging over the edge. Phil sighed when the house lights went down and wang, boom, 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 wang. I'm not sure what that is alluding to. The next night was Box of Rain and had one of the best morning dews ever. Very cool. Yes. You agree? Knobstead?
Oh, no doubt. No doubt. Awesome. That second set there, they did a Lost Saint too. So that it was like, yeah. Lost Saint drums, like almost barely a space into do. And then next thing you know, Midnight Hour.
Very cool. Man,
I remember when I asked you to be on the show, the first thing you said was, is that the show with the Sailor Saint do? And I was like, oh, it's not that one, but it is.
but remember the reason why is because on this particular night I went home, it's the night that those people rocked my car and shook it.
Course.
So it's something that's like, you know, it's like, that's like the memory of that is, excuse me, the show itself is. But, you know, all these things kind of connect together. And a funny one, I guess.
Absolutely. So we're going to wrap up. Knob, I'm going to need a funny thing. Thank you. That rhymes with Audify.
Got it.
Our next show, however, is going to be from, again, because everything's random. We couldn't pick the show that Knob's dad wanted to talk about. But we, the randomizer has given us December 7th, 1971 as our next show.
Back
to the early 70s.
No, just kidding.
Yeah. you got me for a second because it's in New York at Madison Square Garden at the Felt Forum. But I think a little bit before your time.
Yeah.
And I don't know what is a There is a soundboard of this show. I haven't listened to it yet, so I don't know if we get... Set one is just Casey Jones. I'm sure more was played, but we have Casey Jones in the first set and a bunch of other cool songs. Looks like a lot of Pigpen stuff. Looking forward to listening to This one from if you had 350 in pocket change, you get in the door. Pretty cool.
Well, it's Dave's Picks 22. Google
right.
tells me. And it looks like we now have that full show. The Dave's Picks release,
but you need a Dave's
all
Picks.
Of set one yeah. that ends with Casey Jones.
And Dave's Picks is not on the streaming services. You just need the CDs for that or vinyl, right?
Yeah, but we'll
yeah. We'll talk. not in front of your dad. So yeah, yeah. Let's wrap up the show. We want to have all of y'all smash that subscribe button, like and share with any Grateful Dead loving friends or family, or even people who don't like the Grateful Dead. Just, you know, have them give us a try. You can find us wherever pods are downloaded, but not the ones that sort of kind of rhyme with a preacher. Bobby is notify. We are on the web at helponthewaypod.podbean.com. You can email us at helponthewaypod@gmail.com. We are always stickied right there at the top of the Grateful Dead subreddit, which is reddit.com/r/Grateful Dead. A really cool place to hang out. And we are on YouTube, just like a lot of those Grateful Dead shows. You can find us by just searching Help on the Way Pod. And with that, I'm going to thank Knob's dad. Thank you so much for being a part of this podcast.
Thank you guys for having me, man. This
was a lot of fun.
Brought back some great memories. So
good.
Hopefully, when the dial spins, you hit a few more up and I could try to get back on.
Hell yeah. Anytime. More than welcome. Knob, any final thoughts?
Yeah, I the same thing. Thanks to my dad for being here. This is a lot of fun, and I hope you, dear listener, enjoyed this as well.
Cool. So after
I always
want to
make
we are
the
done,
audience feel included in the conversation.
It's yeah, important. Absolutely. It's all big family yep. here on the Help of the Way podcast.
No, of course, because they were saying, you know, keep your day job. Exactly. Fatherly advice, right?
My final advice to you all is to stay tuned as we segue into set two nice. Of March 23rd. Thank you. 1986, Spectrum, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We will catch you next week on the next episode of the Help on the Way podcast.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Yes. Still believe. fears. No sooner than that.
way back a couple of thousand years ago. The rest of the story, I guess most of you already know. There was a dude, he tried to bring a little light into the world. That's right. Tried to bring a little light. Love light, talk about love light. Love light, talk about love light. Listen. You can feel it, you can feel it too. Talking about you, me and you.
afraid. You've got to be